Good morning. Let's compare the impulse and the impact force during three different collisions.
Flippin' physics.
But first, it's prom dress day.
Prom dress day!
Bobby, you look very nice.
Thank you, Billy. You do too.
Thank you.
Whatever.
Let's start by looking at the three demonstrations. And now, Bo, please read the problem, and Billy, please translate.
A racquetball is dropped onto three different substances from the same height above each. Water, soil, and wood.
Please stop. A racquetball collides with water, soil, and wood, and the height initial is the same each time. That's it so far.
Bo, please continue.
Rank the blank during the collision with each substance in order from least to most. Part A, impulse. Part B, average force of impact.
Pause. From least to most, rank impulse and average force of impact during each collision.
And Bo, what is that parenthetical statement?
Assume the racquetball stops during the collision with the water and soil.
Velocity final for wood and soil is zero.
Now, I know the racquetball doesn't quite stop during its collisions with the water and the soil. However, the final velocity of the ball is very close to zero, and in a typical multiple choice question you might see, the ball would be considered to stop. So that is what we are going to assume in this problem. But before we do anything else, what is the equation which relates impulse to impact force?
Impulse equals change in momentum, which equals average force times change in time, and impulse, momentum, and force are all vectors.
Very good. Bobby, what should we do now?
Let's look at the different parts of the demonstrations. There is the free fall portion of each demonstration, which is from the moment you let go of the ball to right before it strikes each substance. Let's call that part one, so part one is free fall. For part one, each time the ball is dropped, it starts from the same height, so the final velocity for part one in each demonstration is the same.
Right after part one, the ball collides with each substance, so we can call the collision part two.
And the initial velocity for part two is the same as the final velocity for part one, therefore the initial velocity for part two for every substance is the same.
Bo, please talk more about part two of the collisions.
Okay, we know the ball stopped at the end of part two for both the water and the soil.
So the final velocity I gave before, which equals zero, is the final velocity for part two.
Right. However, after colliding with the wood, the ball rebounds to roughly two-thirds its initial height. So the final velocity for part two, or the final velocity as the ball leaves the surface of the wood, must be positive.
The racquetball is the same racquetball for each demonstration, so it always has the same mass.
Thank you, everybody. It seemed logical to organize this all in a data table, so there you go. Let's take a look at part A, the impulse during the collisions. We know the impulse for part two equals the change in momentum for part two, and change in means final minus initial, and momentum is mass times velocity. So the change in momentum for part two is mass times velocity final for part two minus mass times velocity initial for part two. Billy, what can you do with that?
Well, we know the final velocity for part two for both the water and the soil is zero. Therefore, both water and soil have an impulse of negative mass times velocity for part two initial, so the impulse for the water and soil during the collision is the same. And
Mr. P?
Yes, Bo?
Is the impulse really negative? That would mean the impulse given to the racquetball during the collisions is down, and that does not make any sense.
Bo, that is a good question. Does anybody have any thoughts on that?
The final velocity during free fall, or part one, is down, and therefore negative, so the impulse ends up being positive, or up.
Right. A negative times a negative is a positive. Thanks.
Good. And Bobby, what about the impulse for wood? How does that compare?
Well, the final velocity for part two for the wood is positive.
Therefore, the impulse for the wood must be greater than the impulse for the water or the soil.
Right. Because adding the positive value of mass times velocity to final makes the impulse larger. Yeah, that makes sense.
So the complete answer for part A is that the impulse during the collision with the water is equal to the impulse during the collision with the soil, which are both less than the impulse during the collision with the wood. Part B asks us to rank the force of impact during these three collisions in order from least to most. Bo, please give it a try.
Well, let's start with water and soil, because the impulse is the same for both of those collisions. We know impulse also equals the average force of impact times the change in time during the collision, so we need to compare the changes in time during the collisions. From the video, it looks like the change in time during the collision with the water is much larger than the change in time during the collision with the soil. Therefore, because the impulse during each of those two collisions is the same, the average force of impact during the collision with the water must be less than the average force of impact during the collision with the soil. Yeah, that makes sense. Same impulse with a larger change in time for the water means a smaller average force of impact with the water than with the soil.
Very nice, Bo. Billy, what about the average force of impact with the wood?
Well, we know the impulse during the collision with the wood is greater, so can we just say the average impact force must be greater as well?
I'm sorry, no, we can't just say that.
I think we need to compare the changes in time during the collisions just like we did with the water and the soil. Okay, let's take a look at the collisions with the soil and the wood. I can't tell, Mr. P. Do you know how long each of those collisions lasts for?
Actually, honestly, it's quite difficult to tell. My best estimate is that both collisions last for approximately one frame, which means the changes in time for both the soil and the wood are the same. And it is typical of multiple choice questions you might see to assume that these two changes in time during these two collisions are the same. So that is what we are going to assume.
Well, then, because the impulse for the soil is less than the impulse for the wood, and the two changes in time are the same, then the force of impact for the soil must be less than the force of impact for the wood.
That makes sense. There's a smaller impulse with the soil and the same change in time for both collisions. That makes the force of impact for the soil less than the force of impact for the wood.
Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you. A big thank you to Jan Wery and Judi Lintott of the Ann Arbor Prom Dress Project for lending me these awesome prom dresses. They sell gently used prom dresses at very reasonable prices because they feel every young lady should be able to afford a prom dress. You can find more information about the Ann Arbor Prom Dress Project in the description of this video. Thanks.